Greeting to all. My name is Charlotte Mercier and I am a lecturer at the University of Florence. In my presentation, I'll be talking to you about the initial imperfections that affect the steel scaffold structures. First, I will begin with the introduction. At Los Londoners Ratio, the behavior of a member under pure compression is governed by its cross-section resistance. The failure occurs by equilibrium bifurcations. As the slenderness ratio increases, second-order effects appear and failure occurs by equilibrium divergence. The intensity of these second-order effects is influenced by the presence of initial imperfections. In Europe, the design of scaffold structures must be carried out in accordance with these two codes, and there are two methods. The first consists of taking into account initial imperfections and second-order effects in the global analysis. So the verifications of the structures is made from the resistance criteria in cross-sections. The second method does not require to introduce initial imperfections and second-order effects in the global analysis. So, the verification of the structures must be carried out using the interaction formula. Whatever method is used, the accuracy provided by the verification criteria is based on the assessment of the initial imperfections affecting the scaffold structure. In the verification criteria, the parameter for estimating the degree of initial imperfections is the imperfection factor alpha. This imperfection factor is determined by the five buckling curves. Buckling curve A is used for outward tubular section, so an imperfection factor of 0.21, and buckling curve C for cold form tubular section, so an imperfection factor of 0.49. These buckling curves were established by the European Convention of steel constructions in the 1960s. Based on experimental tests, our objective is to confirm or not the conventional value of 0.49 for cold form tubular section. To this end, the presentation will be divided into three parts. In the first part, I will talk about the experimental test carried out on simply supported elements. In the second part, I will present the experimental test carried out on scaffolding ladders, and finally, I will finish with a conclusion. Let's move on to the first part dealing with the simply supported members. The test on simply supported elements were carried out on two types of elements. The first was simply steel tubes, and the second, here, steel scaffolding standards. For each of these two elements, these two sections area were tested. In all cases, the height of the tested elements is 2 meters. The purpose of the test setup is to analyze the buckling behavior of these elements. For this, each element was tested up to failure under actual compression, using the loading frame which applies a vertical load on the elements. Screwdriver supports were the supports of the tested elements to ensure pin-jointed supports. A displacement sensor was placed at mid-height of the tested element, so we measure the lateral displacement of the elements during loading, and we obtain the experimental load displacement curve. Here are the experimental load displacement curves obtained. We then compare these curves to the theoretical ones using an imperfection factor of 0.49, which is relative to this type of section. Thus, it can be seen that the theoretical behavior of cold form tubular sections do not reflect the real behavior of such cross sections. We therefore conducted a statistical study of the experimental results in order to determine an imperfection factor based on these experimental data. in order to be able to compare her results with those obtained during the CECM test campaign, we carried out this statistical study according to the same methods used in this test campaign. This allowed us to determine two conventional failure load values, 53 kilonewtons and 46.7 kilonewtons. With these conventional values, we were able to represent them among the buckling curves here. It can be seen that the experimental results are closer to the A0 curve than to the C curve. So, using the European buckling curve equations, we were able to determine these two experimental imperfection factors, 0.13 and 0.12. These two values come from the experimental results and allow a better estimation of the initial imperfection affecting these elements. Moreover, if we take the load displacement curves and establish the new theoretical load displacement using these imperfection factor, we can see that they can better reflect the real behavior of the tested element. The weakness of the test on simply supporting members is that it can only measure the initial imperfections affecting an isolated member. However, in a complete structure, other imperfections may occur, such as inclination between vertical components. We therefore launched a second test campaign in the laboratory. In this second test campaign, the elements tested were scaffolding ladders consisting of 4 standards of 2 meters and 3 transoms of 0.7 meters. The material used came from 3 different European suppliers. The total height of the ladders is 4 meters, which is the height recommended by the European standards between 2 anchor points. 2 configuration supports were used. The first was screwdriver supports to serve as pin jointed supports, and the second was clavices and screw jack feet, which correspond to the actual supports of the scaffolding structure. Here is the test device used. It is composed of 2 loading frames enabling to apply the loads by hydraulic cylinders, an impedant structure to ensure the assembly and the restraint of the tested ladders. Here the tested ladder. 2 wire ropes to restrain the out-of-plane displacement of the tested ladders. A trimmer to transmit the load between the loading frames and the top of the ladder. And a displacement sensor placed halfway up of the ladder to measure its horizontal displacement. For each ladder tested, several loading and unloading cycles were performed. As in the first test campaign, the displacement sensor is connected to the data acquisition unit, and this made it possible to establish the experimental load displacement curve. As before, these experimental curves are compared to the theoretical ones. Here are the load displacement curves obtained for scaffolding ladders with screwdriver supports. It can be seen that the theoretical curves with an imperfection factor of 0.49 do not, once again, best reflect the behavior of this structure. The same observation can be made if we observe here the experimental results of the test on the scaffolding ladders with clavices and screw jack feet. As before, we conducted a statistical study of the experimental results. For this purpose, we represent each experimental test among the buckling curve, and thus we were able to determine for each test an experimental value of the imperfection factor. The statistical study then made it possible to obtain a conventional value for the experimental imperfection factor of 0.25. From this conventional imperfection factor value, we were able to draw the new theoretical load displacement curves. Here is the example for ladders with screwdriver supports. The results for clevises and screw drag fit are given in the article. In both cases, we can see that these new curves better reflect the real behavior of this structure. So, I will hand now the third and last part, which is the conclusion. So, a first test campaign was carried out on the simply supported elements. We were able to highlight that the theoretical behavior given in the European standard for scaffold structures is very far from reality, which is a disadvantage in the resistance verification of the elements. The statistical study showed that an imperfection factor of 0.12 would better reflect the real behavior of these structures. The weakness of this test on simply supported elements is that they do not make it possible to measure the imperfections of a structure in its wall. The second test campaign therefore concerns scaffolding ladders, which allowed us to take this imperfection into account. For these structures, the theoretical curves established by the European standards were again too far from the actual behavior. The statistical study showed that an imperfection factor of 0.25 was closer to the real behavior. Thus, in conclusion, it can be stated that an imperfection factor of 0.34, which corresponds to a buckling curve B, would allow a more accurate but still safe estimation of the initial imperfections affecting the scaffolding structures. This value of 0.34 is valid for certain slenderness ratio between 1.5 and 2.5 for common cross-sectional area and for steel components. In the future, we plan to carry out other test campaigns as to vary the slenderness ratio and the cross-sectional area and see what results emerge. This concludes my presentation. Thank you for your attention and for your time. Good conference to all and goodbye.